Hello friends, today we will be discussing understanding CBS environment, interfaces and auditing, which is covered under Unit 4 of Advanced IT2 program. My name is Kuntal Shah. I am a chartered accountant by profession and I will be the mentor for this session. Please go through the disclaimers. The flow of the presentation will be in this fashion. First, we will be understanding TBA versus CBS. Then we will be understanding CBS security and controls. Then we'll be understanding CBS audit and then the other interfaces and technology. TBA, Total Branch Automation, vis-a-vis core banking system, that is CBS. Let's first understand what is Total Branch Automation. The systems were in place in the banking industry since years. However, the paradigm shift was from TBA to CBS is this one, that in TBA, the computerizations were limited to the branches and were not connected to the regional office or the zonal office or to the head offices. The major difference that was there in TBA is now eliminated under the CBS. So let's understand what were the characteristics of TBA. The branches will have computers and all the functions are automated. However, interconnectivity between computers are limited to branch premises. So the computers were not connected to the other branches. Meaning thereby, if a customer is of a customer of a, let's say, XYZ bank, but under the TBA environment, he cannot go to the other branch and carry out the transaction as smoothly as he can do in the home branch, right? Secondly, the batch processing of transaction was the way of processing transactions. Whereas under CBS, when we look into it, it's an all the branches, back offices, service branches, other interfaces are connected to a central server. All the services or the systems share the same database. So what happens that the information that the person gets is from the same source. So gone are the days where there is an out of date information. We can compare this system to a railway reservation system, wherein we can say that from any point, let's say if a person is in Delhi, can book a ticket from Mumbai to Kolkata. Right, it's not necessary that the person has to be at whether the train should go to the Delhi station first and then only the ticket can be booked. Meaning thereby now with the introduction of CBS, the customer is now customer of a bank and not only limited to the branches. What are the other points? Real-time transaction processing. The transactions gets processed on real-time basis, plus the time of processing of transaction has reduced drastically. Other important part is the MIS report generation at the back end. That's the beautiful part of CBS, wherein the reports are generated, that the push-based reports are generated at through MIS system. Now that reports helps banks and the auditors for the review mechanism. What is CBS? Let's understand that from the definition side. Core. Core stands for Centralized Online Real-Time Environment. In nutshell, it means banks, branches, service outlets, whether automated or manual, or back offices, access application from centralized data centers. Meaning there were, as I discussed earlier, that all the systems will share the common database. The bank's customer, now the important part here is the bank's customer can make the transaction from any branch, ATM, service outlets, internet, phone, at their disposal. So there are multiple channels available to the customer to access the system. When we compare it before 15 years, then we were only confined to the branches where we need to go for the transaction side. Now, the installation part. The software is installed at different branches of the bank and then interconnected by the means of communication lines like telephone, satellite, and internet. Now, I just wanted to make a note here that installation at branches is very minimal, meaning thereby only browser settings are made and not the full-fledged software is installed, because all the core banking systems generally function on a common platform like a browser-based platform with a JavaScript or equivalent to that program. So the installation at the branch side is very minimal. And meaning thereby it can be extended on a very fast basis and the systems are very agile one. We'll be discussing that in the next few slides. Okay, now we will be discussing on the advantages of a core banking system. First, multi-channel support, that is internet and phone support, apart from the branch support, multi-currency support. Now that's the best part that you will find in the core banking system. Now the person can have it transactions into any currency, including the minor currencies, right? Now need not the bank need not have to have the transactions only in major currency like US dollar, euro or GBP. It can now contain all the minor currencies also. The general ledger systems are designed in that way that it will include the transactions in the other currencies also. Multiple lingual support. Now, major hindrance for the computerization was this one, that language or the English language was an hindrance for the rural branches. And that's how the systems came up with a structure that now the multiple language support is also available. High scalability. As we have discussed in the previous slide, the systems system installation at the branch level is very minimal. Hence, it can be expanded at a very rapid speed. You may have seen numerous advertisements wherein they have advertised that today we'll be opening 1,000 branches, 400 branches. The reason is that the central system needs to be updated for the new branches to be opened. And hence, the system installation, once the hardware is set up, then the entire system can be made live. Okay. Now, let's understand in a chart form that what is TBA and what is CBS, and I'll be highlighting the difference between the TBA and the CBS. Now let's check this one. Now this arrows shows you a dotted connectivity and not the full connectivity. The branches are computerized. However, the branches are not connected to a central server directly. In this scenario, the data used to go through floppy disk or in earlier terms, and then the CD or the flash drives. Whereas when we compare it with the CBS, the connectivity is live. Not only to the branches, but to the phone banking, internet banking, ATM machines and the point of sale machines. So all kind of technologies or the interfaces are connected to the central server. So major difference between the two is that way in which it connects to and the way in which the system gets the data from the central server. Okay, now let's understand few CBS used in India and world over. First, let's understand few systems that are operational in India. Predominantly, the banks are using first Infosys and another software by TCS. iFlex, that is taken over by Oracle, is also a software provider for CBS system. Pinnacle, numerous banks are using this. Bank of India, Vijaya Bank, Federal Bank, ICICI Bank, Axis Bank, numerous banks are using this, including the private sector and the public sector banks. TCS banks, State Bank of India and the associates, Central Bank, Allahabad Bank, Bank of Maharashtra is using the TCS Bank, the software solution provided by the Tata Consulting Services. Then comes the FlexCube, used by HDFC Bank, Yes Bank. Now the last two, the Aloha Financial Solutions and the SAP Banking Services, that is by Accenture or all the Alnova and the SAP AG, not used in India, but used other part of the countries in the world. Majorly, we'll be focusing on two predominant softwares, that is Pinnacle and TCS banks, as well as the general concept for any core banking system. So let's go into detail. Let's now understand the architecture side, how the system is made up of. System, now this, you have an image on your screen, sourced from the main software solution provider, that is Infosys. Let's understand one by one. The Pinnacle is not only a system whereby you can record a transaction. It is much more than that. Into the Pinnacle, you have the enterprise CRM. You have the product factory, functional services, reusable business components, accounting backbone, and the infrastructure side. Now, understand with this one that CRM solution can be embedded into the core banking system, which will help to track and to ensure that customer services are at an optimum utilization. Plus, then comes the product factory. Product factory includes setup for all type of products. Let's take an example for consumer banking, time deposits. Retail loan is also there. Savings and checking is there. That is the savings bank account. Then comes the corporate banking, that the current account and syndication and securitization, trade finance, forward contracts, export-import financing, documentary credit guarantees. Then comes the functional services. Now, these are the services that has been embedded into the system, wherein let's go through that the clearing side. Now, clearing will have an entire functional services set up into the core banking system. Then comes the limits and the collaterals, referral systems, sweeps, and the pooling systems. Then there are reusable business components like interest and taxes, exchange rates, bank management, fees and charges, inventory, discounts, signature verification. Now, signature verification is through two means, that you have a signature also. And now, as per the KYC processes, the photographs are also taken from customers. So now photographs are also there, and the board resolutions are also there, where the mode of operation is prescribed. Now, the major part is accounting backbone. We have a transaction manager, which records the transaction in multiple currency and which will post update to the general ledger systems. Now, the entire flow is this way, and when we carry out a transaction through a transaction manager, at the end result, we will find a general ledger through the system. Then comes the infrastructure part. Infrastructure includes 24/7 support, access controls, multiple calendar support, meaning thereby for each state, the different calendars are there, or for a separate branches, the multiple calendars can be there. Schedulers are there. Single sign-on is also there. One system, once it is signed on, it can extend to the other system also. And the other features like auditing and purging is also available. So we have completed TBA versus CBS. Now we'll be discussing CBS securities and controls. Now, let us discuss securities and controls associated with CBS. There are various types of controls that are embedded at various levels in CBS. I have selected only two for the better understanding here. First is the application level control. Other one is the administrative level control and security. Now, let's understand it in detail. Let's go one by one. Application level control. Authorization of transaction as per delegated authority. Now, as you all are aware that in banking side, all the employees or the personnel are given specific authorities. Under the system, that is the CBS system, the said authority is embedded into the system so that the person can access those menus as well as they can process transactions for the limits that have been assigned to them, right? So, important part that we need to understand is this one. And as an auditor, we need to also check that whether the system is configured properly with respect to the delegated authority or not. For that, we need to have the bank's internal instructions for the type of officials, that is the officials grade and the powers assigned to it, and the access table as well as transaction limit table from CBS to verify whether the same is updated properly under the CBS or not. Second point, data input validation control. Now, the best part of CBS is that it has a validation at various stages, first of which is input level validation. As you are aware that in the income tax returns also, we check that if we mention PAN of 11 digit, system throws an error stating that PAN has to be 10 digit with an 541 sequence. The same way, the CBS also takes care of input level validation controls. Let's assume that the gender. Now, male, female, that's the characters are allowed and no numeric values are allowed. Now, those are input level validation controls. The validation control at input level is very useful so that it filters out the erroneous data so as to ensure that at the time of processing, there are no discrepancies or there are no fallback of transaction. Then comes the accessibility in software areas as per employee grade and powers. Now, the system grants access to only required number of officials wherein they possess certain grade or certain power. Reason is that the person, let's take an example that a person is working in a cash department. That person is not supposed to visit the foreign exchange and the trade finance department. And that's why the system will not allow the person to access the foreign exchange and trade menus. It ensures that the employee grade and power accesses the right amount of menus, and the access given to them is eliminated. Then comes the important part and the technical part, that is the product level control. Now, the systems are intelligent on that side, that when a person is selecting a particular type of products, system automatically fetches certain information. Let's go one by one. There are three types of product level controls. First one is prefix financial parameters like interest rate, penal interest rates. So let's assume that there is an auto loan, that is a two-wheeler loan, where the bank is having a product to provide auto loan at 11%. Now those those loans have a card rate of 11%, meaning thereby is, if a person is opening an auto loan account in system, the user is not required or user is not supposed to touch the interest rate. System will fetch the interest rate from the data table and will put up the interest rate and the penal interest rate. Then comes the fixed tenure controls. It is generally assigned to the fixed deposits. Let's take an example that, as we see in the banks, that there are charts available that what will be the interest rate for the different type of buckets, that is 7 days to 14 days, 15 to 30, right? Now all those buckets rates are there into the system and into the database. Person, that is the maker, has to ensure that it enters the deposit amount and it enters the period for which the deposit is required to be opened. System will check 2-3 aspects with respect to the transaction. That is, first, whether the person who is requesting for the opening of deposit is senior citizen or not. And for that, it will refer to the master, that is the date of birth. Then it will check whether the amount is less than 1 crore. Since you are all aware that more than 1 crore FDs are classified as the high cost deposit or a special rate deposit, wherein the rate will come from daily ALCO committee, asset liability management committee held at head office. So in those cases, the rates will be updated manually by the person. And in that scenario, the auditor has to check that whether the rates have been properly updated. In this scenario, wherein there is a predefined fixed deposit open, then the auditor can check that whether, on a sample basis, whether it is functioning perfectly or not. Third one is the tax and regulatory compliances. Now, let's take an example of an NRE accounts, that is non-resident external accounts. And second example of normal fixed deposit account. In the normal fixed deposit account, withholding tax flags, the TDS flags will be marked as yes, meaning thereby TDS will be applicable. But when an account of an NRE type is opened, then the system will automatically mark it as a not applicable, right? So these are the controls associated with the products. So once the products are set up into the system, controls are also associated with the system. As an auditor, we need to ensure that the controls are in existence by test checking the system. The last part under the application control, and very important one to understand, the controlled error handling through warning, exception and error. Now, warning. What is the difference between all the three terminologies? Warning. Warning only warns the user. It pinches the user. It will not have any impact on the transaction processing. Second one is the exception, and very important one. Exception means the transaction is not of a routine nature. It is of an exceptional nature, meaning thereby it requires an authorization from a person competent to authorize that exception. Once the transaction is captured under an exception, the person competent enough to override the exception will process it through his login. Once the transaction is processed, system will capture the transaction and will make it a part of an exception report that will be generated in the next day. The third one is the error. Now, error means system will not allow user to go further. unless the correct values have been fed into, right? So these all are the controls as a part of an application level control. Let's understand few controls of IT administrative control and security associated with CBS. Controls are associated with processing activity also. It allows user to use the software as per access right table. As I have discussed earlier, there will be an access right table which will define that which user can go up to what level under the menu structure. Then comes the confirmation prior authorization for any outside installation, encryption of data, that is the part of the security. To ensure that no changes are affected in IT hardware, it is done through logical access control. That is, each employee is assigned a separate user ID and passwords. Access to system menu as per the grade, type of branch or the service outlet. Single sign-on facility is also available, meaning thereby you access one system and all the other access other systems will also have an access through the same sign-on. Maker-checker control. Now the basic part of a banking system is that the transaction will be made by a person and will be verified by the other person. Now, there are few exceptions to it, but by keeping the exceptions aside, we can say that a transaction has to go through minimum two persons user ID, meaning thereby a person will be entering a transaction and the other person will be verifying the transactions. Exceptions we'll be discussing once we'll go on the later part of the presentation. Security policy for all IT asset is available with all the banks, and as an auditor we need to have the copy of the IT policy and need to ensure that whether the branches are complying with all the requirements of the IT policy. Now we have completed two parts, TBA versus CBS, CBS security and controls. Now let's focus on the core part, that is CBS auditing, right? Okay, so we'll be going in this fashion under the usage of CBS in concurrent audit. First we'll understand the concepts, then menu commands and shortcut keys, then few specific aspects of generation of reports from FinACL, then extraction of information from FinACL, and then we'll be proceeding with TCS banks and the later part with the other interfaces. Let's first focus on the concept side. Okay, general concepts of CBS. Sole ID and set ID. Sole ID, service outlet identification number. Now, sole ID is a general concept. Across all type of system, this concept is there. However, the set ID concept is specifically with respect to FinACL. So meaning thereby we need to understand what are the differences between the two and why two sets of IDs are required. Let's take an example in this way. We have a bank having two branches, one at Delhi, one at Bombay. In that scenario, Bombay is assigned an ID of let's say 11, whereas the Delhi is assigned an ID at 55. Let's compare it with the TBA first, that is the total branch automation first. Assuming that you are a customer under the TBA environment of Mumbai branch, which was assigned an ID of 11, then your account will be under 11 and the transactions will also be processed by 11 since the other branches were not connected in between. However, under the CBS part, you can get your transaction carried out from the 55 branch also, despite the fact that you are holding your account with 11. Meaning thereby now the branch that is entering your transaction and the branch which is maintaining your accounts are different. To ensure that and to retrieve the information properly, the second set of name is given is the set ID. Let's understand first on the narrative part. Sole, that is service outlet ID, that is the branch or the back offices wherein the account is maintained. The second one is the set ID, again specific to FinACL. It is the ID of a branch or a back office who has initiated the transaction. Important word here is initiated the transaction. Now, understand with this one, there are no different set of IDs, right? So Delhi is having let's say 55 ID, so account maintained by Delhi will have a sole ID with 55, and if the Delhi branch is initiating the transaction, then set ID will also be 55. However, for the cases wherein the transactions have been accounted for 11 number branch, sol will be 11 and set will be 55. Right. Now, this is very important one when we need to extract certain information specifically from the pool accounts or the accounts maintained at head office or certain branch level where it's a nodal branch working concept is there. We'll go through in detail when we'll understand the FTI command in Pinnacle and we'll make use of set ID. Now, set ID is also termed as initiating branch ID. Right. So, it's one and the same thing. Then comes the transaction ID and date. Now, TRAN ID specific word is from Pinnacle. In TCS banks, it is known as journal number, a unique number generated after completion of transaction through TM module. The said number along with date can track a particular transaction from database. Now, the number is unique only for a day, right? So, the next day, the number will get resetted, and that's why to locate a transaction, a person is required to have transaction ID and date both. Important part here is that if we are reporting as an auditor certain observations, then we need to ensure that we report both transaction ID and date so that a transaction can be traced from the system. Okay. The another concept is the transaction type and subtype. Right. Transaction type and subtype is like we have in tally system the contra. Contra is a terminology. When it comes to our mind, we can understand that there will be cash to cash transaction or bank to bank or cash to bank or vice versa. Right. So the same thing is assigned here also, wherein the specific types are assigned to type of transaction like cash, transfers, clearing. Right. So for example, I am taking an example. It's not necessary that the codes will be same for all the banks because the customizations can be done by the bank into the Pinnacle system. Let's take an example that cash is assigned transaction type of C, whereas the transfer is assigned as a type as T. Then if a transaction type is C, then we can conclude that this transaction will be of a cash type. Then comes the subtype. Now, we have a cash transaction within which we have a transaction of, let's say, cash receipt or cash payments. So, we'll have the transaction. We'll take an example of, let's say, a code CR is assigned and CP is assigned. So, we can say that when the CP is there, we can assume that it is a cash transaction and specifically cash payment transactions. Right. There is a third type also. That is the patron type. That is nothing but debit and credit. It's a patron type. So it's debit or credit. We'll understand in detail again when we'll be going through the FTI command. Account number formation. Now, each bank is having its own methodology to format the account number. It ranges from 12 digit to 14, 15, 16, 17 digits also. Predominantly that the number is consisting of 3 to 4 items. Now this holds good when the systems are of Pinnacle because TCS bank, there are no specific method of assigning the number wherein we can find certain critical information from the account number. It follows a different methodology. It follows the series of numbers, 3 series, 5 series, 8 series numbers. Right, whereas the 8 series is assigned to branch general ledgers, 5 series and 3 series are assigned to the deposit OD loan accounts. Right, so let's understand a specific set of number. I am taking an example of a 12 digit number under the Pinnacle. An account number, let's say 00990501467 8, is made up of at least 3 things. First, that is 0099, that is the sole ID or the ID where the account was opened. Then come the other two numbers. In case of bigger set of numbers, there will be 3-4 digits also. That is generally reserved for type of account or the sub GL type or the scheme codes. So based on this number, that is the important one. Based on this number, we can understand that which kind of account is this. And just by reading the number, we can understand that this is current account or this is a loan account or this is OD account. The last digits are the numeric. Now, one more digit known as check digit is assigned generally in few system at the end. Let's assume that the check digit is 2. What does check digit does is this one, that with the check digit, it breaks the series ace. So let's say we have a number here 00990501467. If let's say 679 number is open, then what happens that the person will have the sequencing number. So at the time of transaction, the person may by mistake debit or credit the account because of the issue of the series. To break the series, there is a number called check digit is added at the last. So let's say next account if is opened, then it will be 00990501467 8, and then there will be a number. Now that number will not be 3. It will be any number other than 3, so that the chain is broken. So here it's it should be 14679, and then there will be a number, right? So it will have a number other than 3, and it will break the chain of series. Okay, now we are on to the important concepts, that is master level concept and account level configuration. The entire system, that is the core banking system, is based on these concepts or these configurations. Gone are the days that we used to verify only transactions, and we used to feel that we have verified or we have audited 100% of a particular entity. But now the transactions also get initiated based on the master updation. Let's take an example that a person went to the bank and asked for opening of an account. He has submitted his all the KYC documents. Everything was perfectly opened by the branch except for one mistake that the branch official made. Instead of mentioning year of birth as 1983, the person had updated in system as 1933. Now the thing is that system will classify this person as senior citizen. The impacts are at the future time, and provided the person is availing the services of, let's say, fixed deposits. Right, in that scenario, system may identify the person as senior citizen and may give excess benefit, that is 0.5% or 1% as per the bank policy. Right, however, if we go with our transaction verification methodology, we'll not be in a position to verify those things, because we'll always believe that the masters are perfect. Meaning thereby, we need to ensure that as an auditor or as a reviewing official, we should verify the masters also, and we should include it in our checklist. Now, why there are two sets of masters? One is, we can say, the customer master. Other one is the account master. Right. So, customer master will have the customer specific information, that is the static information assigned for an each customer. A customer can have multiple accounts, meaning thereby it functions at parent and the child relationship. So a customer ID may have multiple accounts beneath it. Specific updations like KYC details and everything will be there under the customer master, and specific information with respect to the interest rate or the transaction specific information will be there at account master. So if any error is committed at account level, it will impact the account. However, if any mistake is committed as at customer master level, then it may impact all the accounts under the master. And that is what we have took an example of date of birth updation, right? So as an auditor, it is very important one for us to understand that how the masters are updated and whether the masters are properly updated or not. Okay, then comes the pointing type account. We'll understand it with a example in the next slide. Pointing type accounts are the accounts also known as self-reconciling accounts. Now these are temporary accounts, also known as parking accounts, and the other terminology is the flabby accounts. Now these are parking accounts, but many a times it has been observed that this parking account becomes a permanent account, right? And these accounts do not have direct implication on the financials by way of debit to the profit and loss item or to the other assets in the liability account. These accounts will still remain as the receivables or the payables, right? Now, how it is set up into the system that we'll understand with an example in the next slide. Then comes the interest table master maintenance. We need to understand that how the interest is charged to the system. Interest is debited or credited to an account through the masters. Now, masters are tables. Now, you must have heard the loan as base rate plus 3%. Meaning thereby, if a bank's base rate is currently as 10%, then the loan is sanctioned at 13%. Now, if I say that I update the system as 13% as a static value, that is the fixed value, then in case the base rate is changed, let's say to 11%, then it will remain as 13 if I go with the static updation. But if it is updated as BR plus 3, then it will automatically update the interest table as 14%. Right. So static updation is only permitted when the loan is sanctioned on the fixed rate of interest. Right. Okay. Now, it is not that we need to check only the interest table correctness. We also need to check that whether the interest flags have been correctly updated or not. Now, flags are Y and N. Now, but before that, to understand Y and N, we need to understand the question that will be posed by Finacle or other softwares. It will ask you whether to pay interest. And if I say yes, then only it will go to the interest table at the time of interest run. But if I say that no, or if I say that to collect interest, and if I say no, meaning thereby system will not go to the interest table master maintenance and system will stop the interest charging or payment into that account. Now, as a result of that, there may be revenue leakage of that. It may be possible that because of this, or if it is marked as yes, but the interest table is marked at zero or zero rate table is updated, then also there is a chance of having a revenue leakage here. So we need to check these accounts minutely, how the interest flags are there. But to add a more aspect into it, there is a concept called account preferential and customer preferential. Right. So there are two separate preferential rates are available, within which you have debit and credit and within which you have a positive and a negative value. So, if a let's say an account preferential is given under the debit side minus 2%, meaning thereby if my account is of base rate plus 3%, my current rate is 11 plus 3 with an account preference as in the debit side as minus 2, meaning thereby it will compute interest at 14 minus 2, that is 12%, despite the fact that system is updated with base rate plus 3%. Right. So it will not charge it at 14, but it will charge it at 12. Right. So in the same way, if the preferentials are updated at customer level, then it will apply to all the accounts under the customer. So we need to ensure that whether account preferential or customer preferentials are there or not. If there are any preferential, we need to check how the preferentials have been updated and whether the sanction letters are silent on it or sanction letters have specifically have a mention over of it. Register type and subtype. Now, this will be for the trade transactions. As we have discussed with the other part, that is for the register, that is the transaction type and subtype in previous slide, the same type of register type and subtype will be there, but for the trade transaction. It will facilitate the user to fetch a specific type of transaction, let's say inland bills for collection, that is outward side, inward side, import bill for collection, export bill for export bill purchase, likewise. All the type of bills will have a specific register type and subtype associated with it. We'll understand with an example also at the later part. Let's come to the pointing type account. Let's take an example that we have lifted. Right. So let's take an example of a suspense account, which is of a debit nature. Now, let's take an example that I am working as an employee of the bank. The second person is XYZ, who is also working in a bank. Now, I wanted 2,000 rupees for stationery purposes, right? So, I went to the cashier and asked for 2,000 rupees. XYZ also wanted it for some purpose and he took 3,000 rupees, right? Now, at this point of time, what cashier did was that he has debited suspense account with 2,000 and 3,000 and credited teller account. Now, why the suspense account is debited? Reason is that the amount cannot be debited to the expenditure account because it has not been expended and the bills or the invoices are also not presented by me. So, at this point of time, the account is having balance of 5,000 rupees. Now, after that, let's say after third, if this was the first day transaction, on third, I'd given the bill of 1500 rupees. Right. So, at that time, the user had debited stationery account 1500 and suspense account 1500. Now, the balance under this account is 3500. Now, if someone asks for it, who took 3500? Then we need to say that Mr. K took 500 rupees and XYZ took 3000 rupees. How come we have zeroed in on 1500? We have zeroed in with 2000 as reduced by 1500. Right. Now, under the pointing type capability, now this first transaction is known as originating transaction. Whereas this transaction is known as reversal transaction. Right. So, each originating transaction will be tracked at the time of reversal. So, at the time of reversal, system will ask the user to point it to an originating transaction. Right. And by pointing it out, we'll have a transaction level balancing. And aggregate of it will be that balance of account. Right. So, whenever we have a balance of 3500, let's say then again also there can be partial reversal, there can be full reversal also. Now, menu codes in Finacle specifically to access or to check outstanding entries are IOT, that is inquire on transaction. There are reports also available, outstanding BGL account reports in TCS Bank, as well as there are reports through MS OIRP, MSGO IRP is also there. And bank may have designed their own report in Finacle, right? So these accounts, now it can be named as anything, that is pointing type, self-reconciling, or it can be said to be a temporary account, parking account, flabby account. Important part here is that these accounts are susceptible to fraud and we as an auditor has to verify it that these accounts are nullified on a timely basis and there are no outstanding, long outstanding entries into it. Okay, so now we'll be discussing on the withholding tax flags. Also, we can say that it's a TDS exemption flags. By default, as we have discussed in the product level control also, that the TDS flags will be determined by the products and it will be marked as applicable or not applicable. Let's assume for the resident fixed deposits, that is the deposits opened by resident individuals, then by default, it will be marked that yes, TDS has tax has to be deducted in this case. However, where a person is submitting some forms like 15H, 15G or the lower deduction or nil deduction certificate, then it has to be marked as no. Now, the options available are that where the withholding tax flags should be marked as the customer master level or at the account master level. Now, when we refer it to the 15H, 15G form, it states that a person has to declare on the date of declaration that how many investments from where the person is expected to get an income, that needs to be mentioned in the form itself. And the person is declaring that as on that day, he is having that much investments, right? So the marking is always done for 15H, 15G at account level. However, system provides a facility whereby by selecting a customer ID, that is the ID associated or given to a particular customer, all the accounts on that day will be marked automatically into the withholding tax flag. However, any accounts opened after marking 15A, 15G will not have the exemption marking. To check that, if a person has marked withholding tax exemption as customer level, it will extend to all the FDs, including the future FDs, right? So important part, we need to check that in how many cases the exemptions have been marked at customer master level and whether the interest payment is exceeding the total exemption limit available to the customer or not. Okay. So now comes the freeze flags. Now freeze will not allow any transaction into the system. Freeze can be of three type: debit freeze, credit freeze, or both. Meaning thereby both case will not allow any transaction into the system. Debit freeze will not allow debit transactions, as well as credit freeze will not allow any credit transactions. Freeze is generally marked when a notice is from government or statutory authorities is received, or some garnish order is there, or some dispute is there, and the account holders have requested for freeze marking. Right, then comes the general ledger concepts. Very important one, that the aggregation part. Transactions will be recorded in an account. Account aggregation will be there at the GL subhead, and the GL subhead aggregation will be there at GL. Nowadays, a new terminology called scheme codes are also there in between the GL subhead and account. Now that scheme code aggregates the account types. Let's say we have a gold account, right? Doctor's account, senior citizen account. These all are of a saving bank account, but are of different schemes. So different schemes have been assigned, and aggregation at scheme code at certain level is also available. But by and large, when an accounting terminology we'll understand in this way, that the account will have an aggregation at GL subhead, and GL subhead will have an aggregation at GL. Now, GL subhead, we need to have the list of GL subhead codes. It will facilitate us to extract certain information on a set of accounts. So, let's say that if we want to verify that how many transactions of a particular type took place in, let's say, NRE accounts, that is non-resident external account, then we need to understand that, or we need to get through the GL subhead code. Now, what are the functions available at entry and modification? Say, just for the information purpose, that the functions are add, inquire, modify, delete, verify, and cancel. Okay. Now let's understand the transaction events by the user category. A particular transaction can have a five type of events, that is entered by, posted by, verified by, deleted by, modified by. Posting is the event on which the transaction's effect will be passed on to the both the legs, right? So a person can enter, other person can post and verify. However, after posting of transaction, deletion and modification is not permitted. Before posting, deletion is permitted, modification is permitted, right? It has to be ensured that the transaction goes through at least these three events, mandatory events. So a single person can do this two transaction also, and the second person can do this one, or it can be like this way. That we'll check it in the next slide also, right? So these are the events. As we have discussed earlier, exception type, warning. Warning warns the user for possible error based on prefix criteria. Exception allows user to override it. However, the transaction will be recorded in exception report for the day. Error, do not allow user to proceed further unless the correct values are filled in by the user. Right. Okay. So now, as we have discussed, that we'll be discussing on the maker and checker matrix for valid transactions. As I said, maker, that is the first person, can enter a transaction, other person will post and verify, or a third person can also verify, but minimum are two. Second one is a maker will enter it also and post it also. Now here is an asterisk mark. Asterisk mark says this one: posting activity depends upon rights assigned to each user ID, right? So if a person is having a power up to posting of transaction up to, let's say, 50,000 rupees, then he can post the transaction up to 50,000. However, in that scenario, if some error is cited by the person who is checking the transaction, then in that scenario, the transaction has to be verified first, and then the reversal transaction has to be processed. Now, here I would like to remind the point that I left earlier, that was that as an exception. In normal process, all the transaction will go through the maker and checker transaction. However, now the Reserve Bank of India also permits the cases and the banks, based on the risk assessment, certain type of transaction of a low value will pass through only through the maker, where the other verification will be through the offline mode. That is verification of reports, printed reports, to ensure that whether all the transactions have been processed correctly or not. Why this specific changes have been made? The Pareto analysis or the 80-20 analysis says that the 80% of the transactions are consisting of only 20% of value, but the 20% transaction consisting of 80% of value. Now, focus should be more on 20% transaction, because if something goes wrong in that transaction, then the risk will be higher into that aspect. However, since the user is more focused on number of transactions, and if he is more engrossed on petty transactions, in that scenario, then his focus may not be that much will be there for the 20% transactions also. So many of the banks have now gone ahead with removing of the checker for generally cash transaction less than 40,000 rupees, 50,000 rupees, right, where the single teller will be in a position to post the transaction, and later on the verification process will be there. Inventory locations, another concept. Now, inventory locations are like the cupboards, that the physical inventories that we are having. In banks terminology, inventories are checkbooks, demand drafts, that is the blank checkbooks, demand drafts, pay orders, that is banker's check, fixed deposit receipts, and traveler's check, and like that way. Generally, inventory locations are like this way, that there will be a branch location, there will be employee location, and there will be external location, right? So let's assume that inventory pack of 1,000 DDs arrived at branch. So the transaction will be posted that this 1,000 DDs, blank DDs, stationery that have been transferred to the branch location. Now that branch location will be in physical custody by dual officers, right? So it will be the dual lock custody. In system also, it will be shown under the dual custody or the dual lock system. Right. When a person that is at the counter is asking for, let's say, 50 drafts, blank drafts, then from branch location, 50 will be transferred to employee location. So now the branch stationery stock is at 950 and 50 at employee location. Now when employee issues it to a customer, then that draft will go to external location again, that is outside the bank. Let's say he has issued one draft. So now the inventory in system for a particular employee stands at 49. Now we can have the balancing at each of these level except for the external level, right? So generally what as an auditor we do is we verify the inventory from the manual register that is kept at the branches, right? So instead of that, we need to verify through the report from system. Now report can be accessed through ISRA. Now ISRA is option in Finacle, and in TCS Bank also there is a module called VPIS, right? Valuable Paper Inventory System. We'll discuss in detail in the later part of the presentation, right? So we can generate the report from this thing, and we can get the list of outstanding inventory, and we should verify physically with the inventories available. Right. So there can be various locations. Now, these are only for examples, that external location. Now, this part and this part. This is the main location and this is the sub-location. Right. So these are main location and there can be sub-location. FL is generally given for the Forex location, and EM stands for employee location. Right. Zones concept in clearing module. Zones are actually collection of same set of instruments, that is for easy identification of type of check and the proper reconciliation. Various zones are open for high value check, interbank check, KYC check, MICA check, non-MICA check, warrants and CMS check. So it only gives an identification to a particular set of transaction. Now, an excellent concept and excellent updation into the CBS system is limit and limit node concept. Now, it is with reference to Pinnacle only. This specific part that I am discussing. The same setup is there in TCS banks also, but the beautiful part of Pinnacle that we'll be discussing will be quick. Now, let's quickly go through it. Credit limit can be set up at account level as well as node level for deriving the drawing power for a customer. Now, if a customer is sanctioned a limit, then the limit will be sanctioned at the account level or as well as node level. However, managing two or more accounts with drawing power deriving from the same security, we need to have a node concept. Now, node works as again a parent and the child relationship. Interchangeability of limit among the different account is possible when we are working as a node concept. Monitoring of overall exposure to a single client or a group of client is possible. So we can now monitor at the node level that which are the limits outstanding and what's the exposure for a customer. Exposure to a select commodity and security is possible, right? So let's understand what is a limit node concept. Limit nodes are used to group accounts under one node to enable easy monitoring and organization. A limit node can be linked to a security for deriving drawing power. Distribution of overall group may be group of client or a group of account, limit to an individual member is also possible through the creation of parent node. So you have a parent node and then you will have the sub nodes, right? That is the child nodes, right? So let's understand with this example. This is a kind of a sanction letter for a particular set of customer, right? Now, there are two major type of facility, that is funded and the non-funded facilities, within which we have a term loan, we have WCDL, working capital demand loan, that is the CC, cash credit account, bill purchase or the bill discounting limits. Under non-funded, that will be an LC and BG. Now, the limits to an individual facility is 225, 75, 250, that is for TL, WCDL, CC, BP. When you sum it up, right, it comes to 300, 250, that is 550. However, we have put a capping here of 500, meaning thereby total funded exposure cannot exceed 500 and total exposure to customer cannot exceed 1000 lakhs, right? So we can give a interchangeability of limit. Let's say we have a CC and an OD account also, and we wanted to give an interchangeability of limit within which, or we wanted to give it with the LC and the BG interchangeable limit, wherein the LC is 300, BG is 300, but it should not exceed 500 lakhs, right? So this is how the parent, the nodes are created. First, there will be a parent node, then there will be a child node, within which there will be another node, and likewise, right? So you have a one node here, second node here, third node here, you can have the fourth here, and then within which there will be accounts. And in this case, there will be LC transactions and BG transactions. Right. So this command, we can access the, or we can check this through two commands, that is LTL in Pinnacle and LNDI, that is limit tree lookup and limit node inquiry. We have completed the important part, that is the concept part. Now we'll be going on to the application side of the software through the menu commands and the report types.